I think we can start. So welcome everybody and good morning. Thank you for being here today. So I know there's quite a huge crowd probably now in the auditorium, but thank you for choosing this talk. I hope to make it worth your while. The topic for the next hour is going to be reactive Spring UI patterns. My name is Risto, and for the past 9 years, I have been working at Vardin, building all kinds of web application and especially web application UIs. And early on during those 9 years, I really fell in love with functional programming. So functional programming and anything related, including reactive streams and reactive programming. I noticed kind of early on in our UI projects that a lot of the time when we did the projects, a lot of the code was just getting data from different backend systems, mapping, filtering, combining, displaying data according to what was selected in the UI. And then when I saw some early presentations on how to use functional programming, like Scala, for example, it was mapping, filtering, all the familiar concepts. So I was like really drawn to it. I thought this really describes what we're doing really nicely. And I just used it everywhere, to everything. I completely went overboard with it. In the end, we got everything working. But I think at that point, I also noticed kind of the dangers of taking on new technologies, taking new kind of paradigms and approaches to programming, where maybe the technology isn't ready or it's new, or at least the team is used to something else, they're used to a different way of working. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done before you can start these new kind of technologies. Later on then came the Reactive Manifesto, Reactive Streams, and I did some really early prototyping with Akka Streams at the time. Also noticed that working or doing anything with those early access software is really hard. Luckily for everyone else, I didn't have a project to apply the streams on, so everybody was safe from my enthusiasm about them. And then later on, again, I noticed that, hey, Spring 5 is adding reactive stuff. This is awesome. I need to try this out. So I submitted this speech, again, built the examples with snapshots, with early access stuff. That was really an awesome experience. Luckily, as of today, Spring 5 and Spring Boot have some concrete versions. So if you try out these examples I'm going to show later, they will work just fine. But I'm not sure if the past 9 years I've really learned anything, since I'm still kind of taking on early access software and trying to build things with them. In this talk, I hope to give you some ideas on how reactive programming affects the kind of UIs we do at Vard in server-side UIs, and how you can use those paradigms, those new concepts, to improve UI code, build better UIs, and improve the readability of the UI code. And then later on in the talk, or actually hopefully for most of the talk, I should be showing you code examples and giving ideas and inspiration on what you can do with Spring 5 in the UI layer. So, Vardin. Are you familiar with Vardin? Yes? Most of you? Great. So, the past 15 years, or actually 17 years, we at Vardin have been building server-side UIs. So, we have two open source products. We have a server-side framework for Java for building UIs. And that has been really successful for us. And it's also always been really agnostic when it comes to other libraries and frameworks. So, you know, Spring, for example, has always worked really great. And nowadays, we also have a Spring add-on. So you can use some annotations in a Spring Boot project, and everything works really nicely. Then, in addition to that, nowadays, we also have a library of UI components built on top of the web component standard. So that's geared more towards JavaScript developers, also open source. The time we have been building these frameworks and the time we have been building these web applications for our customers, we've always had a certain focus. So we've been focusing on the enterprise, on business application. Not exclusively, but that is something that we do. So in my mind and in our mind, business applications are something that the people using them just stare at for 8 hours a day. They're very critical to what they do. They're very critical to the business. So you can imagine like an accountant using accounting software that is a web application. If that application has UX problems, it has bugs, something like that, they are very apparent to the user. They're very important to fix right away because that's how he makes his living. That's how he does his work. So they are really critical to the business. Typically, they have really long lifespans. So these applications, once built, are maintained for 5, 10, 15 years easily. So they have certain kind of requirements that are applied to this application, which are, I think are kind of unique. But then again, those users that are using the applications, on their free time, they use a totally different set of applications. They use Google, Facebook, Twitter, all these really polished, really well-made applications. And from there comes a different set of expectations for these business applications. Those of usability should work in all the browsers, should look really great and work really great. I think that those requirements make the business applications kind of a unique and a hard thing to do. So, reactive programming. As I was preparing for this talk, I was talking with a coworker, and he asked me that, you know, reactive, what's that? That's something like event-driven programming, right? And I said, like, no, it's this new thing. It's the greatest thing ever. And of course, I was wrong. First, it's not a new thing by any means. Roots in the academia, pretty old already. And secondly, it is actually like event-driven programming. It's just one step up. So when you think about event-driven programming, reacting to events, building a system based on those, reactive programming is just one abstraction layer up. It gives us better concepts, better tools, better ways of modeling the events based on time. But otherwise, it is event-driven programming, and that's great for us because programming UIs on the server side is event-driven programming. So when you build really complicated UIs with really complicated interactions inside the UI, the logic, modeling that with reactive streams can give a lot of benefits. So you have the same things, but you have more expressive code. You can write less, you can compose the operations more easily. Like I was saying before, a lot of the UIs are just mapping and filtering data, just like taking the event flows in the UI, taking data flows from the back end, and then just combining those somehow, mapping, filtering. That's what a lot of the UI programming is. And reactive paradigm gives us a lot of tools and concepts to work with that. And also, of course, which is kind of a great addition if you look at like RxJava versus the reactive standard that's now in Reactor and in Spring 5, back pressure is also really important for the UIs, especially when you have hot sources that push data really quickly. You don't want to choke the UI, especially the browser. You don't want to push too much data into it. So the kind of volume dial that was mentioned in yesterday's talk is really, really important. So you can go even further. So you can take the events in the UI and then actually use reactive to model the UI events and use the streams to drive UI logic. So not only the data, or actually let's forget about the data. Let's just think about the UI that has some logic, has some way that, you know, buttons are shown and so on. So if you think about the events, you have a button, user clicks it, it creates events. You can model that as a stream of events. You can model a text field as a stream of value changes. Then it just takes those streams, map, filter, combine again, and drive those into a UI component to drive some logic. I'll show some examples of that later. So what happens then is that when you're programming UIs, it is simply taking data sources, wiring them up, and pressing play or subscribe. And everything just works like magic. All right. So next I'm going to move on to the code examples. So first, I have three examples on server-side UI programming, on server-side reactive UIs. First, I'm going to show something just using Flux, a very simple example, just to show you how it works, how the project structure looks like, and so on. Second example, I'm going to show you how to map data with the UI events, and how to do some somewhat more complex wiring. And then on the third example, I'm going to show you how to do UI logic with the stream, so forgetting about the data. So, as always with Spring projects, when I was building these examples, I started with start.spring.io. Go there, check Vardin and Reactive Web, generate project, you're good to go. So, let me switch on to IntelliJ here. There we go. So, I could actually show the project structure really quickly. So all in all, it's a very standard Spring Boot project, just taken from the initializer. The only change I did to the dependencies is, yeah, this one. So I added the dependency for Vardin push. What this does, that since we're doing a lot of asynchronous stuff, this enables the kind of built-in mostly WebSockets-based server-side push in Vardin so that we don't have to worry about it and we can push updates from the server to the client automatically. Otherwise, pretty standard stuff. So if we look at the application, no changes there. Just standard Spring Boot application starter. And then let's look at the first example. So, for those of you who don't know Vardin, so in Vardin you always extend from a UI class and you implement the init method, and then Vardin guarantees that whenever the user accesses this URL, the init method is called. I have a few annotations here. So this one is from the Spring add-ons that I mentioned earlier. So Spring UI annotation with a path makes this UI auto-configurable and it's discovered by Spring Boot automatically, so I don't need to configure any servlets or anything like that. This just means that this UI will respond to the example one path. That's it. And then push annotation. So this annotation, together with the dependency I just showed, those kind of activate the push support in Vardin, and then we can use server-side push. All right. So, then the code. So I have a weather service. That's kind of not the focus here. It just uses the new web client to fetch something from some weather service somewhere. Maybe the most important thing is that it returns a mono of weather result. That's all I want to know about that service. And also, I push a lot of the kind of layouting code to some other classes. Again, those are not the focal point here. You can take a look at the examples later on if you want to. But then here we move on to the kind of interesting stuff. So again, this is a pretty simple example. So we take a button. Actually, I could probably show you first how the UI works. So I have a button, and if the network happens to work, yes. So it goes to the internet and fetches weather information. Yet another weather app, excellent. So here we have the button that was just clicked. Add a listener, and when the button is clicked, we start loading. Simple stuff. we show a loading indicator, hide the button, and then we do our request through the weather service. So we get the weather for this current location, and we subscribe to the result, call show result when we get something, and that hides the loading indicator, sets the data to some display component, and then sets that as visible. The only kind of interesting thing here, I think, is the access. So that's a Vadim term. So whenever you wrap something inside access, that guarantees two things. One, that I can freely modify the UI from a background thread. So from any thread, I can always call access, do UI modifications, and those are guaranteed to work. And second, after the access block is finished, then Vadim will take care of you that those changes are then pushed to the client, to the browser. So this means that when the weather service returns from some other thread, access guarantees that we can modify the UI and those changes are then updated. But that's all there is to this example. So using streams in a very, very, very basic use case, essentially how we're using them here, they're nothing more than fancy futures in a way. You do a call, you get a value in some other thread in an asynchronous manner. It's nice, it's clean. Maybe not the full power of reactive streams, but just to show that taking them into a project, starting to use them, it's really, really simple. Especially, I like the new web client in the Spring 5, since, like I said, a lot of the time the UIs are just calling a lot of different backend systems, usually through REST, so I think web client is a really awesome addition to the toolbox. And if you have any questions about the code, just shout out so we can discuss them while the code is still visible. All right, second example, I can show you the UI. Looks pretty familiar. Yeah, almost the same thing. Looks pretty much the same. But on the code level, there are some changes I made. So again, pushing the UI code somewhere else. Here's the first interesting thing. So we create a mono for getting the geolocation. So this is just a very simple piece of Vadim code I wrote for getting the geolocation from the browser. So this geolocation extension from the server side goes to the browser, gets your location, and comes back in an asynchronous manner. Okay? So we have a mono that has the current location. Then here we have a flux, a stream, of button click events. So this means that we have a stream of UI events. Every time I click the button, a new item is emitted into the stream. And here is kind of the wiring up part. So I like that the init method is really short. It's very readable, at least for me. So here we take the click stream. So every button click comes here. We side effect, start loading, so this does the same things, shows the loading indicator, so on. We could have done this without side effecting with a map, for example. I just wanted to try out something different. Then we map the click into an item from the current location mono. So this means that every click results in a geolocation. How that happens, I don't really care. I will show that later on, but from the perspective of the init method, I don't care. There's a mono which I can get the geolocation and I map clicks to that. Done. Then I map the geolocation to a weather. Again, I don't care how it works. I know that I get a geolocation here and I pass that to the weather service. So unlike the previous example, we're not now using the actual geolocation from the browser. And then subscribe exactly the same thing as last time. So nothing's different there. Let's look at these two methods now, how we created the mono and the flux. for the init method. Let's look at actually this one first. Create weather clickstream. So I think this is a nice short example of wrapping normal event-driven APIs into Reactive, into streams. So what's happening here, I get a button, just normal varding button, nothing special there. I use a helper, flux push. And essentially what that allows us to do is to create a push-only stream. So it doesn't really make sense to request more data from a UI component. Like a button, it just creates clicks when the user clicks it. It doesn't create more clicks when you request more clicks from it. So push allows us to create a stream that just pushes data. Then what we do is we take the varding button, add just a normal listener to it. So whenever the button is clicked, varding calls flux sync next. So this is provided to the flux push method. So this just maps that when the varding gets the button click, we emit a new button click event into the stream. And then we just clean up after ourselves. So when the stream is closed, we remove the listener. So this is pretty much how you'd wrap any normal, simple, event-driven API into a flux stream. And this works really well with any UI component in varding. Next is the geolocation mono. So this is slightly more complex because it's an asynchronous API. So the geolocation extension works in a way that I call ask location. At that point, it promises me that at some point it will go to the browser, ask for the location, and then later on come back and call the listener I provided. So I use mono create. It's a single result we get, so mono is the way to go. Mono create geolocation listener. So we take the mono sync that's given to us, and once the listener is called, we call success on the location. And then we just add the listener, fire up the query, and again, clean up after ourselves. So when the stream is closed, we dispose of the, or we remove the listener. But those were there just for the example. In reality, I don't care how the streams are created. All I care is that I get monos and fluxes in some method, and then I can just do operations on them, compose, map, filter. That's the way I want to write the methods. If there are no questions about that, I'll move on to the last example. So maybe I'll start by showing it this time. This is slightly different, so I finally got tired of the weather examples. So this is a super complicated insurance price calculator. You can select age here, or age range. I can select a city, let's go with Barcelona, and it gives me a price, awesome. And it updates live, so when I change the age range, I change the city, there's a new price calculated, pushed to the browser automatically, that's it. And when I select 15 to 21, not old enough for this insurance, so we first show the notification for the error, second, we hide the price label. All right, let's look at the code. So again, we have just some service that calculates insurance prices, not important right now. Then we have the three UI components I just showed. So we have the selector for the age, for the city, and then a label for showing the price. These are almost like normal varding components. They have some additions. I'll show them in just a minute. But it's important to realize that these are, for the most part, just server-side UI components in varding. They have some data. These are very simple DTOs. Nothing special about it. Again, the UI code is pushed somewhere else, and this is, I think, the most interesting part. So first we take two streams. So from both UI components, the age selector and the city selector, we get a stream of value change events. So then we can use those streams with another helper from Flux called combine latest. What that does, it takes two streams and takes the latest values and uses those with a method I provided or the function I provided to create a new item. And whenever one of the streams emits a new item, that item plus all the latest ones from the other streams are used to again create a new combined item. So how I use this, I take the age stream, I take the city stream, and then I push those into the insurance service, calculate price, and as an end result, I get a stream of price results. So whenever any of the UI inputs change, there's a new call to the service, and I get a new price result. I call share here because I'm going to use the same stream in various ways, so I don't want to do any extra work on that. So let's see what we do with the stream. There's price label that gets a value stream. So we take the same price result stream filter so that we only get the successful queries. So the 50 to 21 ages, they get an error result back, but otherwise we get a success. So we want to only show the successes in the price label, and then we map the price from the price result to a string and show that. That's it. So now the values in the price label are connected into the age stream and city stream through this Flux combine latest. Then we do same kind of stuff for the visibility. So as you noticed, we hid the price label when we got an error. So now we connect the visibility of the price label into the price result is success. So we just map the price result into a Boolean, so we get a stream of Booleans. And last, for the notification, we take the inverse in a way, so we get the price result, is failure, get error. So we only get the failures in the notification, and we get the error message in the notifications. Next, I could show you quickly what I did for the varding components to get these value streams, how I can call, let's say, set visible with a stream straight to a varding component. How does that work? It's really, really simple. So radio button group, standard varding component, nothing strange there. I just added one interface with a default method. That's it. And this is the exact same style, using flux push, adding a listener, mapping the values from the listener to a stream. That's it. That's pretty much how you do any mapping event-based APIs into a stream, except now it's for the value changes. That's it. That's all I need for these reactive components to have this get value stream that I can use nicely. Then the reactive combo box, exactly the same thing, just added the one default method from the interface. And then we have reactive label. This is kind of the inverse, it takes in streams, it doesn't produce streams. But nothing special here either. It just takes the streams that are given, subscribes, and then uses the same access we used in the previous examples to update its own value. So that means that it updates its own values at the access, and that is then behind the scenes automatically pushed by Vardin to the client side. And the exact same thing for visibility as well. Nothing special, we subscribe to the stream, we use access to modify our own visibility. That's it. And again, for me, the important thing is that this init method is short, it's succinct. I just get a bunch of streams. They are components that I can give streams to. I do some business logic. So in a way, the logic of this UI is here. It's the combined latest that produces the value. So the price result is the DTO that is needed for the view to do something. And once we have that, then we can configure the UI logic with streams. All right. That was kind of the, I think, the main part I wanted to show you. I wanted to show you how to use Flux in a server-side UI, how to map data with data flows and UI events. And then I wanted to show you how to drive UI logic with streams. But I think since I have ample time and no questions, so I could show you something that wasn't, I think, covered in yesterday's talks about front-end technologies and how to use streams with them. So I can show you one quick example just to kind of, again, demonstrate that using streams, using reactive streams with Spring 5 on the front end isn't very complicated. How many of you are familiar with web components? No? Excellent. Good opportunity to teach you something. Okay, web components is a new standard for the browsers, so it's a web technology standard that is now being implemented or has been implemented by most browsers, at least parts of it, since web components isn't just one standard, it's four standards. So there are custom elements, which allows me to define my own, let's say, spring-io element, and then I can use that in HTML, just like any HTML element. There are templates, which allow me to create element trees in the DOM, and then later on, take those and stamp them wherever I want. So what that means in practice is that I can create like a class, like a skeleton, for an HTML element, and then when I use that HTML element, the contents of the templates is stamped inside it. So it's much like defining a class in Java, and then you instantiate it, and all the fields are there. Then we have Shadow DOM, the third standard. That allows encapsulation. That allows me to do stuff inside my element. So I've defined a custom element. I can do stuff inside it and hide that from everyone else, especially CSS rules, for example. I can encapsulate the contents of my element. And that's already at work. For example, when you look at some media elements that show some kind of player controls, those player controls are often rendered by the browser using something like Shadow DOM, and these days actually using the Shadow DOM standard to create those buttons and all those things you see there that you can't really access yourself from the DOM. And the fourth is HTML imports. Simply allows me to import any HTML file. In practice, that's used to import components. So not unlike I can do in Java, I can import a class in order to instantiate it. In the web world, I can import an HTML file and then component in that. So now you're probably wondering that, yay, yet another JS framework, yet another front-end technology to learn. But I think that web components is very different from the other kind of new stuff that's always coming on the front-end side. In the beginning of the talk, I talked about business applications and that they have requirements for support and they have long lifespans. And you really want to use kind of standard technologies, technologies that implement standards in business applications, because you know that they will be there for a long time. You can use them in 5-10 years. And web components is just that. It's a standard. It's not something that some company invented, yay, here's a new framework for us. It's a standard being worked on now, being implemented by browsers, and it will be there. It will be supported for a really long time. So building stuff based on web components is, I think, a really safe bet. Second, it's a primitive. you can use web components in React, for example. They are something that you can build reusable components, use them to build applications, but also use them with other frameworks. They are not, web components are not a framework in itself. What we usually do when we build web components, we use a helper called Polymer. It's from Google. And now you're thinking, you just said that no frameworks and now there's Polymer. Polymer is just making things slightly nicer. It's like early in the days, like jQuery helped us to use standard web stuff, but with a nicer API. Polymer does the same for creating web components. Creating web components with just JavaScript and HTML isn't that complicated. It's actually really easy. With Polymer, it's even more easy. It's slightly nicer API. So we have been using Polymer for building web components, and Google has also used Polymer. For example, the new YouTube is built with Polymer. So if you go to youtube.com/new, the YouTube team has been using Polymer and web components to create a really nice experience, I think. So if you haven't checked them out, I suggest you do it. They are interoperable, so you can use web components from different providers. They just work with each other really well. And I can, since I have time, I can show a quick example. Yeah. So it's the same Spring Boot project I had. I just threw some HTML files to the static resources. Maybe not the best way to deploy them, but it was far the easiest. So I just want to show kind of how kind of easy and simple they are to use. So in index.html, I import the polyfill. So this is a standard polyfill, pretty lightweight these days for web components, since many of the standards are already supported by the browsers pretty well. Then I'm using one of the standards, HTML imports, to import a file called WeatherStream. Happens to contain a component, element or a web component as well called WeatherStream. And then I instantiate it, I use the component. So it's just HTML, it's just an HTML element, that's it. That's all it takes. I'll show you the contents, but I can again show the UI. Not very polished, but it does the job. So I don't have any imagination, so I did another weather stuff. So this is the same as you saw in the keynote, I think, where there was a high charts chart that had stock data. This is the same kind of thing. It's just a grid that gets weather data pushed from the server by using Reactive streams. I'll show you how that works. So obviously there's some logic here in the weather stream element. So first we have the imports. So I'm importing some other components I want to use in my component. Pretty familiar patterns. I take a paper button, that's from the Polymer team. I take body grid, that's from us. And then some helpers to do layouting in here. So we have a template, one of the standards. So here I'm creating the DOM tree, the HTML elements that will be inside my component. So all of this will be stamped into DOM when this here is kind of run or rendered. So I think the interesting parts are here towards the end, where is the actual, this is how it looks like. So we have a button configured with attributes. This is very common. So you do some declarative configuration with just normal HTML attributes, and then later on, if you want to configure them, you use properties. Normal properties, nothing else. So we have the paper button, adding some styling when it's clicked, call this function. Then there's body grid, again, just HTML, using the same template standard here to configure the columns. So we have three columns, one for time, then summary and temperature, as you saw. That's it. This is Polymer specific. I could do this with JavaScript as well, bind the data into it. I just like this for the readability, but by no means do you need to use this. That ends the template part, the part that's inserted into the DOM. Then there's the script part. Scary JavaScript. Again, this is standard, ES6. No transpiling, no anything. It just works in the browser. So I do class weatherstream extends Polymer element. If you're not using Polymer, you extend HTML element. Again, interesting parts are, I think, here. So when we click the button, we call get weather. Use a geolocation, like in the server-side examples. Just now we are on the front end, we're doing JavaScript. So we can do it maybe slightly more easily. And then this is exactly the same kind of code that you saw on the keynote, using an event source to map into a server-side stream. And whenever we get events, the on message is called, and we add stuff to the grid. That's it. And here's the custom element standard. It's that easy to use. So the weather stream is just a string. So what this means at that weather-stream, this will map to this class. So we map one element to one class. That's it. That's all it takes to create this component. We have been building these web components now. The Polymer team is building. There are other companies as well building web components. So I think that in the future there will be a nice variety or nice selection of web components to use in your applications. That's it. So any questions? No questions right now. Feel free to come and talk to me after the talk. There's the GitHub repo for the examples. I'll tweet out the slides and the GitHub repo as well after the talk. Thank you.